Are we good? Good. Here on behalf of the petitioner this evening, I'm going to have Steve start out with a presentation, and then I'm going to follow up with some technical items, items that staff asked us to address, as well as Mr. Kestner had communicated last week with staff, and Alexia sent us an email with those points, and we wanted to address those for the board's consideration this evening.
Hello and good evening. For the record, my name is Steve Pittman. I'm here representing Hoffman Developer LLC, the contract purchaser of the property and hopefully a developer of the property. So first of all, I want to tell you we have some unbelievably good news, and I think the type of news that you guys always want to see somebody attempt to bring to you, and that is we have support from the adjacent neighborhood, Saddle Creek.
Is French for open air or outdoors. So plein air is just outdoor painting. So we move out of the artists move out of the studio and outside to paint. So that's what we're doing here.
I am here at the farmers market in Carmel, and it is the quick paint, which means you have an hour and a half to start and complete a painting. And it's a really good exercise, you know, to work fast, lay it down right the first time. So that's been a lot of fun.
Okay.
The Carmel Farmers Market is a fabulous place to begin with, and we always pull a nice-sized crowd. A lot of appreciative people here, so they're going to come and also see the paintings. The artists have a chance to show them to a lot of people because you have a crowd already here. So I think it's fun. I think everyone appreciates it.
I'm from Springfield, Ohio. And I came to Carmel because I heard so much about it. I've joined IPAPA, which is Indiana Plein Air Painters. And so when they talked about Carmel on Canvas, I couldn't wait to come here and paint. And then I got here, and the town is amazing. There is so many things to paint. The compositions, you just turn around, and there's something new and great, and there's all sorts of interesting venues. I love it.
The third place winner, Robin Wright from Springfield, Ohio.
So I think we were driving past the Carmel Arts District yesterday, and we saw a bunch of artists painting over there. So that was the connection, and we were like, oh my god, is it the same art? So we came in, and then we realized that they'd done it in like 1.5 hours, and we were looking
at the plan that we have today. But the other part about this plan I think that's so important is the fact is, and I haven't emphasized it enough, is how it plays in with not just our 60 acres, but the 15 acres adjacent to us, and how that property, that's going to become, a project will be coming in my opinion, the not-too-distant future. It's not going to be single-family detached housing. It's going to be more, in my opinion, you'll be going through the same process as someone comes in with something more dense, housing, commercial, whatever you're going to see. But they play off of each other, and they're important. They go together, and you know, as part of that, how we've connected in with our pathway system, and how we're going to connect. So before I go too much further, you all have seen this letter, and John, if you would pass this out to the committee members, it would be great. As he's passing that out, and you can see that, I just want to read to you the letter that we received that I'm ecstatic about. The president of the Homeowners Association, Brian Kavicki. And you know, I do want to say something, I hope people are listening in Washington, D.C., is the process that we went through here is the way debate should occur, and it's the way people should interact with each other as opposed to being hostile. And you believe one way and this person believes another, and you become enemies. I found that the president of this HOA, Brian Kavicki, was very professional. Another individual who's also on their board, Mike McKeever, who lives on Saddle Creek adjacent to us, the leadership that they showed in their neighborhood and the way they came to us and were with genuine comments. Sometimes you hear people that say, oh, there's a bald eagle, and they're like, take care of that. Oh, there was an owl. Oh, there was a snail darter. And the goalposts keep moving. They didn't do that. So I want to be complimentary of their professionalism, and I hope and think they feel the same way about us. But What Brian wrote was, he says, to the committee, over the past month, Steve Pittman has worked with residents of our community to minimize the impact of Ambleside development to those most closely affected. With the addition of the lane narrowing, raised crosswalks, median plantings, we've been told that the traffic will enter our neighborhood much slower than originally proposed. The neighbors on the southeast side of the development have agreed that wider lot lines as well as additional plantings on both sides of the property lines meet their request to minimize the impact of the community literally in their backyards. We still maintain that we do not wish to expand our pond and have requested that the connection be through a pipe connection. The board does not think that working with another community to maintain a shared pond is the best plan long term. In our past experience, the communities adjacent to us have been both underfunded and unwilling to jointly do anything, and we've been left with the financial responsibility anyway. We do understand that this decision is in the hands of the Drainage Board and plan to attend those meetings. Even though there were always indicators that a residential development would be placed on that property, people resist the change. At this time, we feel that the developer has done what we have asked to minimize the impact of the change. As an HOA board whose responsibilities are limited to protecting property values, we can support the Ambleside development. Brian Kavicki, President, Saddle Creek Homeowners Association. So I wanted to share that with you, and I thought you all would be equally as happy as I am about it. This exhibit here that I put in front of you, and John has shared with you as well, this is an area where our neighborhood is directly adjacent to Saddle Creek, and we were showing lots that were 65 feet wide next to their lots that were 80 feet. And the way we measure lot lines as a builder or developer is the lot width at the building line. And as we continued to negotiate and work with them, they asked, would you guys consider widening your lots adjacent to us to 80 feet? And in addition to that, would you guys plant four trees per rear yard, four 7 to 8 foot pine trees per rear yard on your property, and then come over on our property and plant four more trees, and 7 to 8 feet, and stagger them, and how we're going to do that, we work that out. And so we met with seven property owners, and we agreed to do that. And we show seven property owners here, starting north to south. These six people here have all signed that agreement, and to now that they support this project. In addition to doing that, as we showed you before, this area right here is the area as we worked with the owners on Megan Drive, and they asked us to create a common area here and put an entry feature, and we've put a park bench or two, and we've raised cross speed tables and crosswalks in addition that will help slow that traffic down there. And then the last comment that I'll talk about, then I'll hand it back to John. This is the area where we're connecting into Saddle Creek on Beaumont Drive. And in fact, we worked with those properties owners. I see that Tashir's here tonight. And ultimately, they don't want that connection to occur. And I think the decision has been that that connection does need to occur. What we've done is we put in the boulevard entry the way they've asked us to do it, landscaping on each side, trail, and then also a proposed speed table with crosswalk to make that connection to occur, slow traffic down as well. I guess the last part of that where we talked about creating this common area here on Megan Drive, when I talked to Brian Kavicki, the president of the association, he asked me on this connection right here if we would consider putting in a fence there to create that separation of our lot and their common area. I told him if that was something they wanted, we'd be willing to do, and he decided that that wasn't necessary. So anyway, that takes care of, I think, the adjacent property owners we worked with, and now I'll hand it over to you, John. You want this up here?
Thanks, Steve. As I indicated, there were a couple other items that I wanted to cover. One is the items that were outstanding in the staff report, as well as the communication we received from staff regarding Mr. Kestner's comments. First, before I do that, not to go word for word, but to review the explanation in our brochure, the additional items that have been addressed. First, as Steve indicated, the lots along the perimeter here adjacent to Saddle Creek, those have been enhanced to 80 feet wide as part of the agreement that Steve had reached with the neighbors. Second, regarding the dog park, there was additional detail added to that and a 10-foot asphalt path that would connect the street within Ambleside Point to the Baker parcel to the west. Additionally, regarding the pond to the south, Steve had really gone through that in detail. That text is added to the PUD. So in essence, the PUD specifies that the pond can either connect as it's illustrated here or connect via pipes. And that decision will be made as part of the development plan review and include the drainage board input regarding that topic. Also, staff had requested a tree preservation exhibit. That exhibit is identified here and it's been added to the ordinance. Darren Mendham, the urban forester, had asked for consideration of one additional item to be added for clarity to the ordinance. His communication was copied to staff and we've agreed to add that language to the ordinance, which talks about landscaping within common areas, in particular those spaces along the perimeter of the lots that are in this vicinity, as well as the area between the townhomes and those courtyards. Regarding traffic calming, Steve had outlined for you the adjustments that were made at Megan Drive as well as Beaumont Boulevard. And then regarding dwelling architecture, we met, I think, two if not three times, had Zoom meetings with staff to go over their additional considerations that they would like addressed, which resulted in staff support of the architectural standards as you have in front of you. There were numerous revisions. As you'll recall, the tie-in was to the Village of West Clay standards. That document's 100 some odd pages. Staff asked us to extract from that the proposed standards for this development, which we did, and we added the items. A couple of the highlights from that would be that at least 50% of the houses would have a front porch that was 6 feet in depth. And I believe, as Ms. Westermeyer, you had requested, we made some modifications regarding the masonry of those homes, which would be along townhomes, which would be along the perimeter of the site. So the sides facing the street here, facing 146, facing this street, and the sides facing the internal street, those would all have a minimum of 40% masonry on the front facade rather than the prior standard. And staff felt like that would address the comment that was made at the last committee meeting. Lastly, again, as Steve had mentioned, this illustration shows those plantings that would be on adjacent lots, as well as plantings that would be on the lots within the development. Those plantings that are on lots that are not part of the PUD, that are off-site on the neighbor's yard, those are part of a written agreement between Steve and those neighbors. You won't see that in the PUD, but nonetheless, it's part of a written agreement between Steve and the neighbors themselves. All that is encapsulated into a red line ordinance that you'll find under tabs 9 and 10 of the brochure that we produced that shows all the changes from the last meeting to this one. I'd like to now go over those four final items from staff. One was that the staff had mentioned, this is at the end of the report, the fire department has requested a minimum width of an alley pavement to be increased to 20 feet. We agreed to that. Mr. Kestner had also offered that observation that it was necessary perhaps to have wider alleys to staff. Those it would be in Area B, so the alley north-south and east-west alleys here and here would be enhanced to 20 feet in width. That was to address the notion that there is not a street or a lane in front of the homes that would face the interior common area. Likewise, regarding that, I think Mr. Kestner, you had brought to staff's attention, you wanted to make sure that there was a minimum of 20 feet for parking, that standard is in the ordinance. So we'll have a 20-foot alley, and outside of that 20-foot alley, there would be a 20-foot space for parking in every driveway outside of the garage. So all the townhomes would accommodate parking, two-stall garage, plus two behind, plus the 70 additional parking spaces that we have shown, plus on-street parking, and there's another item that I'll get to in a minute. Staff had requested some additional parking along the south end. Mr. Kestner, you had offered that observation as well last week to staff. That was their communication to us. And we're agreeable to add to the PUD that there would be parallel parking added to the north side. We had considered doing a head-in parking like we've done up here next to the park. But there's homes directly facing the street, the intervening street here facing north, and we didn't think aesthetically that would be appropriate to have head-in parking along there. But parallel parking and having that parallel parking striped along the north side, it may require a couple more feet of asphalt on the north side, so you'd see a little bit of a bump out, but all that would be striped. And staff communicated to us that they felt like with the striping, that would encourage people to use it and have it identified and visible for people to use if they were needed additional parking when they're visiting some of the residents that had that fronted on the open common area. So we've got 70 plus parking spaces on the north side. This would accommodate between 15 and 18 additional parking spaces that would be striped on the north side of this intervening street. So that was the third item that staff had noted in the report. Can some parking spaces be added to the south side of Area B? The last item staff had noted was pleased to add language to the PUD regarding a unique feature to be provided in the playground, and I think that was a result of comments that Ms. Westermeyer, you had made at the last meeting, and we have agreed to address that. And I've got the text here that we had reviewed with staff earlier today. Best efforts shall be made to incorporate a unique feature in the playground area that is not provided in a common area within a mile radius of the real estate, so that to the extent that it would be unique or different, we wouldn't provide something, the same thing that's provided in an adjacent neighborhood. So what does 1 mile mean? It's Ditch Road over to Shelbourne Road, 131st or the Village of West Clay, north to 156th Street in Westfield. So we would have something different than what's provided in those spaces. We don't know what that different is today, but it would be filed as part of the development plan with the real estate and returned back to the Plan Commission for your consideration as well as staff's at that time. So the last segment of the discussion, and I wanted to make sure that we addressed, Mr. Kestner, your comments that you provided to staff. Make sure I've got it. There it is. In that regard, we addressed the alley widths, the widening of the alleys to 20 feet from 17, as staff had communicated to us. The driveway lengths have been addressed. Those would be a minimum of 20 feet. Parking along the south edge, we had addressed. Another item staff had noted was that for consideration, the courtyards of Carmel, which was a development that came before the committee earlier this year, they had called to our attention the anti-monotony provisions in that development for us to look at as a benchmark, if you will, or at least a basis of comparison. And when we looked at that, we looked at it and we had found, and I talked to staff about that earlier today, we had found that the courtyards of Carmel, this is their standards. The black represents the homes on their development. This is the subject lot. The black would be adjacent lots. These are the five homes that are regulated that couldn't be the same elevation. Our provisions in our PUD regulate not only these homes that are identified in black here, but also a five-run segment on the opposite side of the street, which can't be the same elevation. So we could emulate that, but it would be, in essence, a reduction of the proposed standard that we have in terms of repeating a certain elevation. We aren't proposing to do that, but we did want to call that comparison because staff had identified, and I think it had been mentioned previously, that subdivision, that we regulate a broader section in terms of restrictions of duplicating elevations across a particular frontage. The last item that staff brought to our attention, and I have a photograph here that will help illustrate this, Mr. Kestner, so that we can show you that we addressed it. So these are examples, the photographs here are examples that we took some photos of side yards and situations where there's narrow side yard setbacks. And if I'm not mistaken, Mr. Kestner, the staff communicated to us that you had suggested the use of an ornamental tree to help mitigate or screen some of the side yard. And we felt that it was more appropriate. You can see a situation here where there's a tree here. There's a tree here. We would still have trees in the front yard. But we thought, and then you can see another picture here of the area between two homes, that it would be more appropriate to use shrubs to screen the AC units than it would be to have an ornamental tree there that wouldn't provide year-round screening or really screening of the AC units. If you're walking down the street, because the house typically sits a couple feet higher than the the sidewalk, ordinarily when they grade lots, that two shrubs to screen the AC units, each AC unit, in that situation would be, hopefully, in our opinion, address your concern about adding some landscaping and making sure that there was some screening going on, then it would be an ornamental tree, but I'll look for your comments that on staff. Staff thought that would be appropriate, so we would offer up that addition as well. That concludes all the items and updates that we wanted to provide, respectfully, we would request that the committee consider a recommendation to the full plan commission this evening in consideration of the information included in the brochure as well as the updates that we provided this evening. If that occurs, we will work with staff diligently to provide by Friday an updated red line as well as an ordinance that would go out to plan commission members in brochure form on Friday this week. Thank you.
Thank you. The petitioner has made many changes over the course of the review of this process. At this point, they've addressed all of our comments, and as was stated previously, we are supportive of this PUD due to the high level of architectural requirements, pedestrian-friendly streets, walk and bikeability, the mix of housing types, and the overall connectivity of the neighborhood. In addition, they provided a large amount of open space, tree preservation, and they provide, we believe, an appropriate transition from 146th Street by locating the townhomes along that street and then moving south, providing single-family alley-fed lots, and then along the perimeter, slightly larger single-family front-load lots. So with that, I agree with what the petitioner stated this evening, our conversations and the changes that they've made. We'll look for those changes in their packet if they move forward to Plan Commission and make sure everything gets added. But at this time, we would recommend favorable consideration to the Plan Commission. Thank you.
Thank you. Committee?
Okay. So I like the number of changes that you've made. You're moving in the right direction. I do like the 80-foot wide lots. I think that provides an opportunity to have a variety of housing types within the same development. That's good. My questions at this point, you know, it might be just clean up the language in the PUD, but my primary concern is still on the townhomes, because when I read the text of the PUD, it states that you can permit up to 6 units per building. Your concept plan shows 30 buildings, so per math, that opens the door to 180 townhomes, and the total width in the lot line is 16 feet, so that's pretty narrow. That seems like a lot. I don't think that's your intention, but I'm going to reiterate my request to have the number of townhomes reduced, and if it's at all possible to save some of those trees around the existing house that are being cleared to make way for these townhomes. And then my other, just really clarification, is the tree line on the South Pond. I didn't see anywhere in the PUD where that was designated as a tree preservation area or neighborhood common areas, and I do think the one of the primary purposes to reconfiguring that pond is to save the trees, so I'd like to see that they are in fact preserved. And then the comment about the courtyard, and I guess I'm just going to throw this out for everybody's consideration, one difference there is in that PUD we held firm on requiring four-sided masonry and trim along the windows for all the units. You know, that's not in this PUD, so I just throw that up for conversation. So, I mean, those are my concerns, comments at this point.
We'd be glad to limit the number of townhomes. I believe the number is somewhere in the neighborhood 130,
okay.
as proposed, so we could add that identifier in the ordinance. With regard to the landscaping along the south perimeter, this is that exhibit staff asked for specificity,
right,
that shows the tree preservation along the south,
yes,
the south property line.
Mm-hmm.
One other item, and I apologize because I almost interrupted you. Our ordinance specifies that every house, every side, masonry. That's 360. So you won't have an elevation that doesn't have masonry. At a minimum, it would be a masonry wainscot on all houses.
So that's, we're talking about four-sided on all four sides. The way it reads right now in the PUD for Area A, it states that there's four-sided masonry at least at a wainscot level, but there's a carve-out for 25% of the buildings that are not required, and then it's very vague on Area B. So again, this might just go to trying to clean up the language of the PUD.
And I apologize, the carve-out is a provision staff suggested, so if there's a house with a particular architectural style that doesn't warrant that, mm-hmm. that we could have as many. So we're talking about in Area A and Area B, as many as 13 of the homes in each of the two districts could have less masonry than that minimum standard. It doesn't mean they can't have masonry. It just means that they could have less than the standard, which is all four sides.
And then trim on the windows. I thought that was vague, too. Are we in the courtyards, we require trim on all the windows.
Yeah. I'll make sure that the specificity in the ordinance establishes that it's okay. Every window, every development. The architectural standards are broken down into four separate sections. One section, the first section, is overall applicable to all areas. The second section is Area B. The third section, Area A, then Area B, then Area C. If you look at Area A, it'll have a section on windows, and if it's not clear in there that every window receives the wrap, I'll make it clear, okay. And we'll meet with staff to address that.
Okay, great. And back to that tree line real quickly, since you've got the map up. So there, you know, a portion of the tree line goes across lots. So it's possible that a future homeowner could cut down those trees so they have a clear view of the Saddle Creek Pond. That's another reason why I was requesting for that first lot to be common areas. But if there is some way to designate that tree preservation area or neighborhood common areas within the PUD, that would be appreciated.
With that regard, we'll do one of two things. We'll either squat up that lot and there'll be a band along the south end that would be common area, so it would be clear that it's not on the owner's lot. There are some other situations where there's tree preservations on owner's lots because they're behind these lots here. Along this edge,
mm-hmm.
So we'll do one of two methods. Either we'll specify it as an easement on the lot, or we'll make it part of the common area.
Okay,
making it part of the common area is a little stronger than the easement on the lot, but both have the same weight.
Okay.
In the event that there was some damage or disease damage to those trees, it would be the obligation of the declarant to address the deficiency.
Okay.
I'm not saying that'll happen, but there's mechanisms in place that guard against the unforeseen.
Okay. Well, those are my comments for now.
Some of the things moved in the right direction. The reason I kind of suggest a tree instead of shrubs between on the east side, those homes on the east side, they line up and you can see all the way through. The ones on the west side are kind of
staggered,
so you don't look completely through. So that was why I was suggesting a tree or something to break that up, because going down the street and looking. But you've added some more parking. My two major concerns that I'm still having trouble with is the density of the townhomes. I'm not against townhomes up there, but I think it's way too dense. It's more like something you'd see in Midtown and not in a suburban area. And my other problem is having a house that doesn't have a street in the front. You know, your front door is the alley. And even you could put in a single wide street, you don't have to put in a double street. And you could do it one way, so that your street is narrow, but at least you got a street in your front yard. Those are my major concerns. The other thing on the monotony, what you showed there is not what we approved for the courtyard. That's what they proposed originally.
With that respect, the ordinance is the one that went, is at council today?
Well, it didn't get changed then. Because it was, you could have the same thing every fifth house. This one, you can have the same house every third house. So if something happened and it didn't get in the courtyard, that's what we, I thought, agreed to.
I don't remember anything specific about every fifth house. I just looked up the ordinance that was sent over. I know there was more details was looked at with the number of elevations that were approved. So, or floor plans. So they increased that number, I think, and they increased like the colors and the brick or the masonry. So originally it was all going to be one stone, and now they're required three masonry colors at minimum. I don't remember specifically about it being every third, every fifth, but that, I think that is what is at council, what John showed. But I think what John showed, like I said, is just the that little monotony mitigation part, but above that in the ordinance, there's more details requiring like minimum of eight, I don't know if it's eight floor plans or if it's eight combinations of elevation, so that part is a little bit more, requires a little bit more. I can double check on that too from the minutes and things, but.
I might be wrong, but I think that was, does anybody else remember that or?
We had, it was really the number of the floor plans and the elevations. We had, I wanted to say there were nine, but, so that when the anti-monotony came through, there had to be so many that you just couldn't duplicate them. But it really wasn't based on exactly looking alike. I thought it was pretty substantive. I was wondering, I'm sorry.
No, I'm through, but I did.
I was going to segue onto that, which is why wouldn't you have five and five, five on each side. You have across the street, you know, you show five homes that won't look like this home. But then, if I looked at that right, every other home could look the same on the same side of the street.
And that was the other one we were showing you. This is theirs.
This is.
And the blacks are the ones that the blacks are the ones that can't be the same on ours. So this is the star's the subject lot. Homes one and two over, that can't be the same elevation, and all five across the street can't be the same elevation.
There's nine.
Right, out of these nine houses, only one can be the same elevation.
So every, okay.
Can you, do you have yours, John, that you can show? So we're not confused by the other one.
I mean, we thought it was pretty aggressive, and based upon our looking at the other plan that was reviewed, we thought that it was, this is the map that's in ours, this is the blacks, the subject lot, and one and two over can't be the same, and likewise one and two on the other side, so there's a run of five, and a run of five on this side, the subject being the third lot, the number three on there. It can be the same. It doesn't mean it's going to be, it just means it can be. And if you look at the site plan, on our site plan, there's some significant breaks in the street network, so that's going to create even, I guess, less opportunity for more duplication than would otherwise be had. We don't have a situation where I think we've done others in the past and other developments, and typically it was similar to what I'd shown you, which was the other development, which is three across the street and one on either side. And in talking with the petitioner and knowing that we're going to have a varied home product type, we were comfortable in making this large of a leap into a nine house run rather than a six or five house run.
Go ahead.
Well, that might work because with the courtyard, we were dealing with the same house across the street. Here, assuming that the bigger lots, you're going to have a different house architect, and so it's not going to be that big a deal.
And I think we weren't involved in the other project, but I think that product is, it's more guided to a single buyer. They're more consistent in terms of square footage and style. Even though there will be different elevations, they're more consistent in the general square footage and style. Here we've got a lot more variety that we're dealing with. And that's why I think they were comfortable in making the advance commitment on the not duplicating. They'll probably have a dozen, if not more, different floor plans throughout the area A and B.
How many floor plans are there?
How many floor plans? Mm-hmm. I just say probably a dozen because we don't have a builder.
Okay.
And in the Epcon situation, in the courtyard situation, it was Epcon. They were the petitioner.
Right.
Nick, just the street in front of the courtyard houses, there's a section in the village that is similar to that, and it's really a unique, popular product. It's, I don't know if you've ever seen it, but you should, if you can, drive over there, and you have to get out of your car and walk, because there's a sidewalk separating the cottage homes, and it's really, I think it adds some character to the neighborhood, to an otherwise, suburban neighborhood, a normal suburban neighborhood. I think it really adds some character, so I think you would like it if you saw it. It's unusual, but it's sellable. People like it. Just to go back to the townhome density again, I know this is a sticking point for you guys. How many, I don't have it right in front of me, how many townhomes do we have going in? How many units?
130. So to give you an idea of where that, you reviewed a few months ago an area within the Legacy. And there's two areas in the Legacy that have townhomes. One's right along River Road, and the other one was just west of the daycare. And the one in the west of the daycare had 128, I think, plus or minus. So that gives you an idea of, fitting that in. The other pod was somewhere in the 80s or 90s, the one along River Road. Again, that's not, the 130 is not specified in the ordinance. The restriction is, here is the site plan. And this is back to the comment that Christine made. It's substantial compliance with this plan, the site plan, and as many as 6 homes per building. And that's why I offered up, we would add that specificity that no more, a maximum of 130, so then we're not dealing with a situation where, even though it wouldn't work out right, we came back and we said, okay, there's 180, that's permissible, but then there are all the other lots within the development are larger lots, like 100 feet wide, because you can't do the math. It doesn't regulate the same way, is what I'm saying. So that's why we can add the max cap of 130 on the townhomes within that space. There are some buildings that are 4 units, others that are 6 within those. So those are those 2 matches within the area that I'm looking at for the plan. And we can take a look at that too, because I think we said the maximum would be 6 dwellings. And if we need to look at some additional restrictions there, so they're not all 6, and they can be a combination of 4s, 5s, and 6s, and no more than 130. I think that helps to also help with the monotony.
What does the construction timeline look on that? How many buildings? I mean, are we talking feasibly? What are we talking about? Are we going to have the townhomes under construction well past the single-family residential, do you think, or how? What does the timeline look on? How many buildings at a time?
So it is dependent on the market.
Right.
It's likely that the townhome area would be developed in 1 or 2 phases, meaning put all the streets in. The builder would gauge which lots are going in first based upon logistics of maneuvering materials and putting people in houses away from people with construction or areas of construction. But the numbers that we have here, the areas A, B, and C, as it's been communicated to me by our client, is that the numbers that they position there, they're hoping that it rides out over the same period of time, that home development in area A, B, and C complete within a relative close proximity. They'll start all at the same, and they'll end in a close proximity to one another. It won't be 5 years for the townhomes and 3 years for the single family.
We think.
Well,
depending on the market.
Yeah, if everybody really wants to live on the central common area, and that goes very quick. It could be a lot sooner, but Paul was delayed. Paul Rio was delayed. He's not here. He could probably speak to it in greater detail. If he gets here before we're done with the conversation, I might ask him to address some phasing, additional phasing questions.
Thanks.
So since you're talking about the townhomes, one quick question on the lot width, and this is more of a construction. So help me understand. So 16 feet seems pretty narrow. You know, what are you envisioning these townhomes to look like? Are these, I know I've heard before I was here, we've had some townhomes built that were so narrow and they ended up being very difficult to sell. So tell me, from a construction standpoint, can you have a two-car garage with 16 feet wide? Do we need them wider?
There's an
allowance. Tell me what they're going to look like.
A 16-foot unit would be an allowance that we have in there for, it would be a one-car garage. So that's permissible within the townhome area.
Can we widen those lots so that we would have two-car garages on all the townhomes? I mean, that's pretty narrow.
I can't say yes, but because we want to offer it. To give you an example, if you drive through Gramercy West, which is on the south side of 126th Street, there's a unit. They have a three-unit building and a four-unit building. And a three-unit building, there's a centrally located unit that has a one-stall. So let's say, for instance, if David Weekly were the builder, they would want to offer that modestly smaller unit with the one-stall garage as an option. It's not a requirement. But it's a question, Christine, that we'll take back to Paul and Steve and see if we can get an answer to.
Okay, great.
I'm not foreseeing that would be a challenge, but okay. That's their decision to make.
Because I'm also just trying to think about the living quarters within the townhomes, you know, how that floor plan looks and feels if it's that much smaller, too. So, I would appreciate you looking at that. Thank you.
And the reason we selected it wasn't because we thought all the units are going to be 16-foot wide. So it may be that we just like no more than 10% or no more than 5% of the units can be that unit. It's not 16-foot wide units across the whole development because there's not a market for that. The market is predominantly for two-stall garage on the unit where there's an option for that smaller unit. At a minimum, we'll get you a maximum percent, and it's going to be somewhat really small. I would say 15% at most, but we'll address it.
Yeah, I was going to say the same thing, that we wouldn't anticipate all of the townhomes be built 16-foot wide, but it's more to allow some of those units to coexist in there, and like John said, maybe there's a way we can limit the number of the 16-foot lots or percentage, but I think we're comfortable with that. I think we've seen that in the past.
And it may be that I can come back to you and say none of them. I mean, if that's really an issue that's objectionable, then we would consider eliminating it. I think it offers more variety, but it wouldn't be the issue that holds us from a favorable consideration.
Okay, so this has been going on for a couple months. I can't remember. Have we discussed construction traffic and that you won't be going in at all through? Because if you're going to be building all these at the same time, you've got large vehicles coming in. How are you planning on handling that?
We would require all of our construction traffic to come in and off of the frontage road of 146th Street. And so we would control that by A, our communications, and then B, we'd also place signage down the Saddle Creek end of no construction traffic.
The connectivity down to those two, is that the last thing that would be done, the opening of the road down there? I don't know if that's the first when you build this. I mean, the longer you can, well, as soon as you have your first few units built, you'll have to open up, I guess, those roads. So that's the first thing you're going to do, right? Is make the commitments to Megan Drive and Beaumont and get
We would probably open up one of them. Now, in the past, what we've done, because these issues always come up, like we just did Heritage at Spring Mill just south of the Mormon Temple, and also Woodside just to the north of the Village of West Clay. People had the same issues, and so we went in and we put in a temporary fence kind of across, and then it was later determined, like engineering was really upset with that. They said, we will never allow this again. You know, would you, and then at Woodside at West Clay, we did the same thing because Westwood Estates, the neighborhood just to the north of us, asked us to do that. And the commitment we made was that those fencing or those barriers, those barricades would come down the lesser of 5 years or 75% occupancy. And Westwood Estates actually came to us and said, hey, we know it's not 5 years. We know that you're not 75% occupancy. We want the barricade out because we want to be able to drive through. So that's what we did there. Per the neighbor's request, we took it out. Now, at the Estates of Town Meadow, we had that same issue there. And then I don't know if you remember that, Alexia, and a lot of discussion there, and there was no barricade placed there, and then the people in that neighborhood to our south actually really like that being open because they can get out to Town Road without having to go south to 106th. So we're open if you think there's something that's besides the way we would normally communicate it to the contractors and the way we would do with signage. But I do think we need to be careful with the engineering department this time because they weren't very happy with us.
Okay, well, so I think at a minimum, you could put a commitment of signs up as soon as you open those up, very, very clearly, no construction traffic, as I know you've done before. Yeah. You know, it's hard to enforce, but I think you're right to maybe initially only open up one entrance, just to try whichever one, and almost seems like, well, I don't know, that's up to you and how you build it. I'm not going there. Okay, did you say you were making a commitment that you would not have more than 130 townhomes?
We'll add it to the ordinance. And it may vary by like 10. I think I recall in my brain what the number was. I think it's 130, but if it's not, it's like 130 to 140. I'm pretty sure it's 130. And we'll write it into the ordinance so you'll know before you act on it at Planning Commission.
Well, I think there's a really strong feeling on this committee that you reduce the number of townhomes. And I don't know what you can do, but we would like to see a reduction of that. Is there something you can do?
We'll put a cap in the ordinance.
I was looking to go below 130.
That's something that we'll consider, but we can't make a commitment this evening regarding the number.
So, as you know, we started out at 265 units here. I'm sorry, 285.
280, I thought, yeah.
We reduced it to 260. Mm-hmm. We are willing. I'm willing to make a commitment here right now that we will not exceed 130 units for the townhomes. As you know, we also lost additional units because we widened our lots to 80 feet and had significant conversations with the people in Saddle Creek. About when they talked about density, and everyone that I talked to in Saddle Creek acknowledged that the density of our townhomes, it wasn't their issue. That we were transitioning from 146th Street, and we had that exhibit where we showed density right in our frontage, and then we transitioned to single-family detached. We gave multiple neighborhood examples of how we did that. Now, it was appropriate in other places. We thought it was appropriate here. We originally started out with townhomes adjacent to Autumnwood Farms. Three-story townhomes. We were asked if we take those to two-story. We agreed to take it to two-story. Then we were asked if we take them to one-story. We agreed to take them to one-story. So all along the way, we've lost those units. We're really not in a position to continue to lose units and do all the things we're doing with playgrounds and dog parks and alleys and still have a project that works financially for us. So we hope that you're comfortable with where we are now, but. Yeah, I don't think we did make it clear that we are willing to make the commitment of no more than 130.
Okay. Just a couple more things here. Our president of the planning has sent an email, and I think it was an excellent suggestion, to put some kind of a road connecting the 10-foot path out in front and the frontage road so that people coming out can cross over. Is that something that would be part of their petition, or is that a city? There's no way right now when you're coming out to cross over to the other road, or Unless I missed.
Yeah, let me address that if I can, Alexia, because I've heard that comment and it's been confusing to a lot of people. So in front of our neighborhood, we're putting a crosswalk across the street, you know, with, you know, paint in the street that this is a crosswalk, and then on the there's a grassy area between the frontage road and the sidewalk on the south side of 146th Street, and there's some areas in that where there's like a swale and there's drainage. There's other areas where it's flat. I think there's some areas where you can just take a pavement walk and just connect it. There might be some other areas where you just put a culvert and you put something over. So when someone says a bridge, some people are like, oh, they want a bridge going up over the frontage road. That's not what they're talking about. It's just so people can get from the frontage road to the path on the south side of 106 and not, you know, be walking through a ditch. And we're willing to make that happen.
Okay, so that'll be...
And that's already written in the PUD.
But it really wasn't explained in any detail. How wide will it be, just to define it? Is it a 10-foot?
Yeah, so Sue, there's two connections. One is located here at this entrance, and this would be the extension of a 5-foot sidewalk. So the 5-foot sidewalk would come up to the frontage road, and then it would extend as a striped walk across the frontage road and connect as a 5-foot sidewalk to the path that's on the south side of 146th Street. The connection here will be a 10-foot asphalt path. This area in pink is 10-foot asphalt. The area in the blue color is concrete because it crosses driveways, and we don't want to have asphalt concrete, and then it picks back up asphalt here. This is a 10-foot asphalt path. It'll be a striped 10-foot asphalt crosswalk, then pick up on the other side, the north side of the frontage road, and connect to the path that's already constructed by the county today. So there'll be two connections from our site over to the path that's on the south side of 146th Street that, if I'm not mistaken, is completed between Shelbourne and Ditch Road today, and then further east and west.
Okay, so one will be 10-foot and one will be 5-foot.
Yes.
Two access. Thank you. This wasn't clear to me, and Brad asked.
And in the PUD, it is just written that connections shall be provided between internal paths, sidewalks, and the path along the south side of 146th Street. So maybe to clear it up, it would help to just say by a 5-foot sidewalk and a 10-foot path.
Can you add that?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Is there going to be any update at all on the Indiana landmarks? So
I've been communicating with them for quite a few months now.
Since our last meeting, has anything changed?
So I actually attended their last meeting through a Zoom meeting, and what we were trying to reiterate to them is we're trying to give them plenty of time to plan and make whatever decision they want to make. What's come out of that in reality is they're not really able to make a decision to do something until we file for a demolition permit. So once they get notice of a demolition permit, then they can officially look at it. And but I would tell you right now, it's apparent to me that they don't have, unless they take an action, otherwise they don't have any intention of trying to save this structure or move it somewhere else. And, you know, I went to the effort of putting them with the Parks Department. As I think we all know, the Parks Department just bought a parkland right down the street from us, and it could have been, if it was to be preserved, a good place to put it. But we will submit, so before primary plat, we'll know. We're going to submit a demo permit probably within the next 10 days. That'll give them 60 days. Even though we're not going to demo this structure until after we close, which would be, you know, like May or June of 2021.
And then what will you do with it when the area that's demoed there? What will that be?
With the material when it's demoed?
Not the material, the land itself. I mean, you demo the structure.
Yeah, we'll demo the structure, then we'll build pads like we do on it for everything else. The homeowner also retained the right in our contract to take anything they want out of the home or on the home. And, you know, as of right now, I know they're planning on taking the flooring and a few other items. So I don't think there would be anybody who'd want to take that financially on to try to rebuild that house somewhere else.
Okay. Steve, you might be careful too about when you apply for the demo permit, just because I think it does have an expiration date on it normally.
Oh, the demo permit?
I think so. Might be 6 months. I can't remember exactly, but so just to time that. If you're not going to actually demo it until.
Oh, you do. Okay, you have a certain amount of time. You have to demo it once you get it. Okay, so mm-hmm. I guess they'll have to make a decision, and then we'll have to reapply again if it.
Yeah, just something to think about. I just wanted to be aware. Yeah.
Okay.
Do you have anything?
I move that we send this to the full plan commission with a favorable recommendation.
I would second, provided that all the changes that we have talked about today are made, and I see them written in the PUD at the full plan commission vote.
Okay, so it's been moved and seconded to forward this to the full planning commission with a favorable recommendation. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. No. Opposed? Okay, approved 3-1.
Thank you very much.
Thank
Appreciate
you.
It. And I might mention that my opposition is the density of the townhomes.
Good point.
Thanks, everyone.
Okay, second item is, everybody ready? Second item to be heard tonight is docket number 1909003BOA, accessory dwelling ordinance standards. The applicant seeks to amend the unified development ordinance in order to establish standards and minimum requirements for accessory dwelling units and to amend definitions filed by the Department of Community Services on behalf of the Planning Commission. Petitioner? We are going to have 45 minutes on this evening.
Okay. All right. Thank you. You will recall that it's been now a couple of months since we have discussed accessory dwellings.
I was hoping you could recap a little bit.
Yes. At the last committee meeting, as you know, the proposal started as an amendment to introduce accessory dwelling standards as well as group home standards. And then in the last committee meeting, we spent the time to go over group homes and separate that ordinance out, and it is moving along. It has moved forward to the City Council, where they will take up the group home conversation while the accessory dwelling conversation remained here in the Residential Committee. So the ordinance proposal you have this evening is the same proposal that you received in advance of the September committee meeting. But since we did not discuss that proposal, I left it the same. But to recap the amendments that were made, we have revised the accessory dwelling unit requirements to require BZA special use approval for detached accessory dwellings. And those changes you'll find in under Article 2 of the proposal. We've also discussed and made some revisions to the accessory dwelling standards found in Article 5. And then we have yet to discuss the requirement of 20% of new lots developed in new subdivisions of a certain size to include an accessory dwelling. A lot of the changes that we made are based on discussion here at the committee, as well as correspondence we have received from the public. In terms of kind of general questions and comments from the public. There's still some questions about the purpose of this ordinance, and I want to direct everyone to look back at the preamble of the proposed ordinance for the details. But in short, we believe accessory dwellings can be a solution to our aging population, our higher housing and land costs,
our limited supply of developable land, and a demand for multi-generational living. Coupled with carefully crafted standards, such as those are proposed, and an approval process, we think that ADUs can be incorporated discreetly into the character of new and existing neighborhoods, all while making efficient use of existing street and utility infrastructure that is so very costly for new developments. So again, there are various statistics in the preamble of the ordinance that I would direct everyone toward. Another topic that has come up over and over again are subdivision covenants. And I want to reiterate that owners associations and their covenants cannot be overridden by a city ordinance such as this. So if there is already a restriction for accessory dwellings in a subdivision, that restriction can remain. It's not affected just by the fact that our ordinance would perhaps allow them. It's also been asked if new covenants can be adopted after the fact, and the answer is yes. Owners associations have the ability to add new covenants of whatever type, whether it's accessory dwellings or not. So a city ordinance such as this would not prevent the addition of covenants to a subdivision. I guess to move into the actual ordinance text, and there are other questions that have been raised by the public, and I'll try to address those as we get to those sections. But if you look at, if we begin in on the ordinance starting on pages 2 and 3, the bottom of page 2 is simply that special use fee, that filing fee that I mentioned, for a review of a detached accessory dwelling. And then you'll see along all throughout page 3 the various zoning districts, S1 through R5, C1 and C2, where we are adding attached accessory dwelling units would be permitted by right, and detached accessory dwellings would require residential special use approval by the Board of Zoning Appeals. And there was a we can discuss attached versus detached when we get into the standards. But that's something that has come up. So are there, we purposely wanted to kind of separate attached versus detached dwellings, because it seems like most of the comments and particular concern had to do with the potential for detached accessory dwelling units, more so than someone that might add space to their existing house. We believe that to get into the, I guess, more about the Board of Zoning Appeals approvals, currently accessory dwellings in most places, except in like the Village of West Clay or certain areas in the Arts and Design District, any accessory dwelling unit would require a use variance by the Board of Zoning Appeals. And so that has raised questions. What's the difference between a use variance versus a special use approval versus a special exception? And generally, and John Molitor might want to clarify anything, but generally, the differences are the board's findings of fact for those different types of approvals. Generally, use variances are the most arduous. Special exceptions are that's a process to consider very specific circumstances, as we do currently with short-term rentals, or as we have now proposed
a special exception for group homes. And then special uses are generally looked upon favorably, but all of the approvals rely heavily on the review of the specific site and the context around the site on which they're located. So the advantage of a Board of Zoning Appeals approval is that, you know, you're looking at the site in its context, and it's not a, it wouldn't be a by right, you can just go get a building permit for a detached accessory dwelling. All of the Board of Zoning Appeals approvals also require the same methods of public notice, including a sign posted on the property, publication in the current in Carmel, and letters to adjacent property owners. And the reason we are, even though accessory dwellings currently require a use variance approval, the reason we are proposing a special use approval is that we have previously not had any standards for accessory dwellings. So with the adoption of standards that, you know, we can further adjust, we believe that the special use approval is a good option for these detached accessory dwellings. In this case, a hearing officer is proposed, and a hearing officer is typically a member of the Board of Zoning Appeals that rotates. You know, they take turns each month with all of the hearing officer items. And of course, a hearing officer's decision can then be appealed to the full board if there's a desire to do that. Again, I guess going back to the attached versus detached comments that we've received, currently in the ordinance, for the purposes of setbacks, accessory buildings placed within 10 feet of a principal building would be considered attached. And that's for purposes of setbacks. If you're adding on to a house, the room addition would need to meet the setbacks of the house. If it's an accessory building, there are different setbacks. But we're willing to explore creating a tighter definition for accessory dwellings that might include some kind of a common wall or common space, so it's not just something that is attached or within 10 feet of with a breezeway or something of that nature, since there is that difference between a Board of Zoning Appeals approval or not between the two. Are there any comments or thoughts on the proposal to take detached dwellings to the Board of Zoning Appeals?
Well, I think having that extra layer of review is a positive, so I'm in favor of having that. So I'm in favor of that, but as far as for attached, there's, what would be the normal process today? Just, is there even a process if it was an attached, or do you know?
Attached,
yes.
Dwelling unit, accessory,
right.
Dwelling?
If someone was to add something now, it just...
In most places, it would require a use variance, whether it's attached or detached. Whatever the configuration is, it would require a use variance under today's ordinance.
So does it make sense to have the special use for whether it's attached or detached? Or to have that one layer? I mean, I'm just throwing this out for conversation.
I'm sorry. Go.
Go ahead.
Okay. Attached, let me just make sure I understand. So it will have a kitchen and a bathroom and a bedroom? Like, what defines an attached ADU?
Correct. It would be an accessory dwelling would have living, sleeping, cooking facilities, and could be, you know, separately entered. Whether it's attached to the house or not, it could have its own separate entrance and function as its own.
But it does not have to have a separate entrance, because I'm thinking a finished basement oftentimes has a kitchen, a bedroom, a bathroom, and a living area.
It would need to have its own, to be considered an accessory dwelling, it would need to have its own
separate entrance.
And oftentimes in larger homes, you do have a set, you have an entrance into the basement from outside of the home or from inside the garage. So I'm just trying to
distinguish what the difference is.
If a basement's already dug out and not finished, do you have to get a variance to finish it?
A permit to
finish it out. Okay, so that goes to the BZA now?
That would only be if it is intended to be occupied or maintained separately as its own dwelling. I know that those cases where there's a finished basement with, you know, with maybe a mother-in-law or someone living down there, that occurs. But most cases, and Lex, correct me if I'm, most cases, those inquiries and those things come from, you know, they might want their own, they might want a separate address, or, you know, so they have a separate mailing address, or if they want to have extended family live there for an extended period of time. But
doesn't that need to be defined then? I mean, you only have to do this if it has a separate entrance, it's going to be a separate, separate address.
We already do have a definition of accessory dwelling.
Well, I mean, there are many families in the area who have parents, especially international families, who have parents who live overseas, come and live with them for several months at a time annually, and they have a kitchen, and they have, I mean, anybody who has a set of, you know, a lot of people have a means to cook and a refrigerator and a sink in their basement and a bathroom and a bedroom and a separate entrance, who have in-laws, you know, coming for several months at a time. So, I mean, below grade really doesn't, I don't think that should count as an accessory. I think we're talking more about, we're going to build over our garage, we're going to, I mean, with maybe stairs going up to a door over the garage or below grade, I think.
So clarifying the
there
definition.
There are a lot of houses in Carmel that would fall under this umbrella already.
Mm-hmm. So clarify the definition of accessory dwelling unit. Yeah, that's good.
Yeah, we can double check that and take a look.
John, I think. And I'm just saying maybe, you know, I understand, I totally agree. We don't want to define this to death, you know, and that's not the, but the fact that this is not going towards any hearing, I think it would help people, you know, and I do think, I mean, using your example, so the in-laws come for 5 months, I mean, that doesn't mean it needs its second, a separate entrance or its own address or, you know, I don't know. I mean, I don't know, Mike. If you, I mean, I don't know. It's, but you do. Go, John.
Well, I'll read part of the definition for you here. It has an independent means of access and is owned by the owner of the building, but occupied by another. Now you could see where that kind of becomes a gray area, because if it's occupied by your father and mother-in-law, is it occupied by another? Or are they still considered your family, even though maybe they've got a separate household of their own, you know, bank accounts and so forth? If it's occupied by your former college student or college kid that is now in grad school, are they another, or are they the same family still?
What difference would it make?
But it would be up to the director to first make that call as to whether that was someone who was really a separate family or whether it's the same family. I don't think we can get a definition that's much better than that. I mean, we're always going to have those kinds of gray areas.
Well, I like what you just said. I mean, that's.
But can't we define and say above grade? Because how many people are going to have a stranger living in their basement? And then we also have to think about Airbnbs, and I mean, I think this opens a door for something that we already
prohibit, correct?
But I think they carved out, there is a no short-term rental provision in here.
We specifically prohibit short-term rentals from occurring in accessory.
So I just wonder then, you know, you have to think about safety. So if I have my next-door neighbor who's constantly renting out her basement to strangers through a short-term rental situation, and you have that in several of the houses in the neighborhood, I think that creates an unfavorable environment in your neighborhood. I wouldn't want to live next to it, and cars coming and going and parking on the street. I just think that it needs to be, if it's a separate unit, that's different. It's like an in-laws quarters or a guest house. But if it's...
Well, it just can't be a rental. I mean, if it's not a rental, then we don't...
It can really be a rental on the definition. It just can't be a short-term rental. So
these could be
rental properties how it's currently drafted. But not short-term rental.
Not short-term rental. I said yes to short-term.
No, not short-term.
I'm sorry, what is considered short-term?
That's a good question.
Less than 30 days.
Yeah.
Oh, so you could rent out for like 3 to 6 months.
Now, the question would, again, the examples I gave were the family. Well, are your father-in-law and mother-in-law paying you rent, or are they helping you with the mortgage, or maybe they have the mortgage and you're paying them? You know, there's all sorts of possible arrangements.
Right. Why is this our concern? I mean, I understand if it's a detached unit. That makes all the sense in the world to me, because you're building another structure on a piece of property. But when it's attached, isn't that your... why does the city have to get involved in an attached... Anybody? No?
Well, I don't know if you're asking me, but...
The proposal is that something that's attached is permitted by right, and those that are detached have to go through the extra Board of Zoning Appeals approval. And when I say permitted by right, it means that they don't have a Plan Commission or BZA hearing, but they do have to, of course, abide by all of the setbacks and lot coverage and all of the things that any residential addition or residential building code would require. But they could simply get a building permit to do that without a hearing.
I mean, that makes total sense, but then why do we have to define what that is if it happens within the original structure? Why do we have to define any of it? Why can't they just have their parents live there, or their brother, or whomever, their neighbor who's fallen on hard times? I mean, why do we have to get involved in the attached portion of this?
If you don't want to get involved in that, I suppose we could go into that definition and clarify, well, if it's a relative or a member of your household, that it's not considered an accessory dwelling, that it's just part of your regular house. And I mean, to clarify how the BZA works or how the director works with these things, the director makes a determination, and it's more or less an official letter as to what he has decided the ordinance requires or doesn't require. Someone can then appeal that to the BZA, so it gets resolved. It doesn't have to go to court in order to get resolved. The BZA can then resolve it within, you know, 30 to 60 days. And, you know, our BZA members are pretty wise old heads. And they're not always old, but
I think,
you know what I mean.
we need to require it, too, because currently we don't. And so there is gray area when people ask, can I rent out my basement, or can we finish our basement? And usually we say, I mean, yeah, it's your house. You can have a second kitchen down there. We won't get as involved. But then when people say, well, can I rent it out, or can I have a, you know, build attached unit to my home, let's say, with a separate entrance? And then we say, well, zoning only allows you to have one unit per lot. So single family zones only allow a single family home. And so when you have a whole other unit, that's where it's, right now it's not allowed. So this would be allowing it to make it easier for people to have, you know, whether it's in the basement or some sort of separate, you know, entrance, and it's maybe a smaller add-on to the home with a separate entrance, this would allow that. Whereas today, we don't really allow it, and it's sometimes we have to make the determination, okay, you can do that, but, you know, it depends usually, too, if it's...
Now that goes to the BZA, the attached.
Okay. Yeah, it
Anytime
does. I mean,
anybody's expanding the footprint of their house, because if you're going up or you're going down, it's one thing. If you're building out, I don't know, it's still your land, but closer to the neighbor, you know, right on top of them.
It's still a building permit.
Yeah, I mean, if they were to come to us and say, we want to add on to our house so that we can rent out a whole other unit, we would say, no, you can't do that, whether it's in the basement or attached. If they come in and they say, you know, we want to add on and or we want to finish out our attached garage upstairs or in the basement, you know, and it's going to have a kitchen, and, you know, we don't really have anything right now that says, well, you can't have more than one kitchen in your house, or you can't have a bathroom down there too. So that's where it gets gray, and then we start to drill in with, well, what do you want to do? And, you know, if they start applying for another address or a separate access, you know, entrance, then that's where we say, this is getting to be more of a separate unit, and you're only allowed one unit on your lot.
So that's, I mean, that's where you distinguish it. It's for rent. I mean, if you're renting out your basement or you're building on a addition to your house and you're renting it out, I mean, it's, I think that's, I think that's what...
That's a qualifier.
That's a qualifier.
Yeah. What
right.
are qualifiers?
The qualifier.
Yeah.
In my
well, it
opinion.
Could, I mean, you could don't have to rent it if it was like an in-laws or your child, but if you add on an attachment and it starts to look like a second unit, that changes, I think, the character too. So it's not just rented, but it looks now like a unit and a half.
Well, once again, it has to have an independent means of access. It's owned by the owner, but it occupied by another. It only says by another. It doesn't have. It doesn't say another who's unrelated to the owner, or it doesn't say if you're a family member, then it's okay. It just kind of leaves it open.
I like that right there, though. I mean, otherwise they could build. I mean, does that help define when people come in? I mean...
I don't think we've had a lot of issues with this in recent years, but if the director may have some he wants to tell you about, but I'm not aware of any.
So, couldn't we say you can't have more than X tenants in there per calendar year or over a 12-month period? Couldn't we say it can be rented out but for no less than the 120 days or six months? I mean, couldn't we? That way we don't have people coming and going, like they're running a business out of here, like a hotel, you know?
That's another point. People can run businesses. Go ahead, Nick.
The problem with that is you're not going to be able to control it,
right?
You know? Yeah. So I don't. If you come in and you get a building permit, I want to add on to my house. I want to put another bedroom and a bath, living area. But I don't put a kitchen. Then it doesn't come into the special use. Is that right? There's four things it's got to have. Well, maybe five, an outside entrance. But if somebody wants to...
Living area, bedroom, separate entrance.
But, you know, if somebody really wants to get around it, well, I'll put it on, but you can come through my house to get to it.
What are we trying to accomplish? I guess, what are we trying to accomplish here?
Thank you. We are trying to create a path by which standards are established where there are no standards now, and we know that there is demand for these, so we're trying to establish standards and a path to do it within a reasonable time frame and reasonable standards, so that folks can, you know, in this case, if it's attached, it's a building permit that conforms with the zoning district. As is proposed now, if it's a detached unit, then it goes through a Board of Zoning Appeals approval.
So can we just say this could be just a building permit unless you're applying for something that has a separate entrance and living, sleeping, kitchen, just some qualifiers, kind of like what John read, you know, and then that becomes an attached, you know, when it has then falls. So you have the definition of what is it. I think that's really what it is. What's the definition of an attached dwelling? But I don't think.
I mean, we have a definition of accessory dwelling, and it John read part of that. A dwelling that is attached to or located on the same lot as a detached or attached single-family dwelling, has an independent means of access, and is owned by the owner of the principal building but occupied by another. Accessory dwellings include apartments integrated within or attached to a single-family dwelling, or located in detached accessory buildings located on the same lot as the single-family dwelling. But to further define, and this is where the living, sleeping, eating, the definition of dwelling unit is one or more rooms in a residential building or residential portion of a building which are arranged, designed, or used or intended for use as a complete independent living facility for one family, and which includes permanent provisions for living, sleeping, eating, cooking, and sanitation. So if it's an accessory dwelling, by definition, it has to have the separate entrance, separate means of access, as well as the living, sleeping, eating, cooking, and sanitation facilities.
And it can't be a short-term rental, we can add.
And it cannot, and we are specifically prohibiting short-term rental, which Airbnb.
So for this purposes, can we define short-term rental to be, I mean, if short-term rental is currently defined as 30 days, can we change that definition for purposes of this? And I guess that's a legal question.
Well, short-term rentals are regulated regardless.
Right, but I think our concern
Carmel,
was...
In Carmel, we have the special exception set up for the short-term rentals. So even if you're only renting out one bedroom in your house and not a kitchen, but you're just a sleeping room, that still requires a special exception approval.
Okay.
If it's a short-term rental, that is, you know, a weekend or less than 30 days.
Right, but I think we were also concerned if there's a high turnover in renters, maybe it doesn't fit the short-term rental of 30 days. It's a little bit longer than that. And is it possible to, so that's a legal question. I don't know if you can create a new definition of short-term rental for purposes of ADUs or not, so that it's, maybe it's not turnover every 30 days, but we don't want it to turn over every 60 days or 90 days.
But to Nick's point, I mean, he's right. How do we police that?
How do you police
that? There's really no way unless the neighbors complain.
Okay.
But if you have it,
you know, right.
Well, the way that special exceptions are policed is that staff generally checks to see if they're listed, and if they suspect that somebody is listing one without having gotten the approvals, then they'll check it out. You know, if they're listed with, for example, Airbnb. But, you know, these other things would be a different sort of animal. I don't know if Airbnb does 31 to 60 day rentals. Maybe they do, but I'm not aware that that's a thing these days.
I would just be concerned because I've had clients moving into the area from other parts of the country who have made a lot of money renting out space in their home in other parts of the country where they may have like a kitchen and a bedroom, somewhere attached to their house, and they ask if they can do it here, and I say no. And I mean, I think that just opens the door for something we may not want to deal with. I don't know what the answer is. I'm just playing devil's advocate here.
We currently don't have rental restrictions on any other type of dwelling in the city other than for the short-term rental special exception. We can take a look at that more in general. But is there a certain time frame that you would like to see or explore? 6 months, a year? I mean, it's not something that we regulate now, and as has been mentioned, it would be very difficult to track.
But it protects us in case there is an issue, so.
It sets the expectation.
Right. I don't know. I mean, I don't
have. Is there a lot of demand out there for rentals more than a month but less than 6 months, or? So they would only rent it for 2 months?
People need that. People who are building, people who are moving here and can't find a house. I mean, in this market, where there's no inventory, there's nowhere to rent anything for 2 to 3 months. So it really would open the door, you know, me knowing that, I'd be like, you know, I mean, there are a lot of people who may look at that as a business, and that's not the point of this.
Well, so if you're renting for like a year, is that
six
to
months,
one person? But if you're renting for less than that, what's the difference?
I think 6 months deters people from trying to run a business out of their home, because that's a commitment.
Do you agree?
Yeah, I think 6 months makes sense. Absolutely, because that's what, I mean, to Carrie's point, you don't want this to become a business. That's not the intention of this ordinance. So I think 6 months.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm familiar with a couple of resort areas, and they have a 6 month so that they don't have somebody in every week. And the 6 months pretty much eliminates the problem.
It wouldn't be difficult for us to amend our ordinance to expand the special exception process to cover, instead of anything 30 or less than 30 days, to have it say less than 180 days. I mean, that could be fairly quickly done without making too many adjustments to the existing ordinance.
So I do have one other question on our standards, since we're going through these. I don't know if there's an order, but on this parking, you know, you added conversion of existing parking. Garage parking shall not be permitted unless the same number of parking spaces can be replaced on a driveway or in a garage elsewhere on the lot. My concern was with the replaced on a driveway. So if you convert your existing garage parking, so now you're opening up to permitting everybody just to park along the driveway and into the street. And so
I guess
I want to talk through that one a little bit.
Yeah, we can move into the standards portion. My understanding with the last committee meeting where we discussed this was that the committee was concerned with converting existing garage parking, and that everyone then would just be out in the street or somewhere. As I understood it, that was the real concern. But
I'll let Carrie talk about this, but I thought it was also just the loss of the garage in general. But Carrie can speak on this.
Yeah, I mean, you don't want a neighborhood converting their garages into living area. It's a comp killer. It would depreciate the neighborhood if you had several houses do that. My
suggestion would be if you convert your garage, then you have to build another garage with the same number of bays that the original garage had. So if you had a two-car garage, you build another two-car garage, three-car garage, it would be a requirement that you would have to replace that garage, whether it be attached or detached, depending on the covenants. But I would say the house needs a garage.
Okay, so the concern with this proposed revision is the replaced, is the on a driveway or in a garage elsewhere on the lot. So if we strike on a driveway, then that. That is line,
is,
starting line 169.
Yeah, that's where it is. So can replace, right, so yeah, striking on a driveway. That works.
Okay. I guess going back to the beginning of the standards portion, I wanted to clarify a couple of things that we, questions we received. The intent regarding the number of accessory dwellings, we were asked a question as to whether one could have a detached and an attached accessory dwelling, or if you have a large number of acres, can you have more than one? And the intent is that there would only be one accessory dwelling, period. Not one attached, not one attached and detached, just one, period. So Nick, we'll keep an eye on your place now. But we can, if we need to clarify that to be more clear, then that can certainly happen.
Does everybody here agree with that? There can only be one or the other.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Then yeah.
Can we go back to the definition of attached? We didn't come to a decision on that. You know, I think somebody said, sometimes it's considered attached if there's a archway or a breezeway. And I would define that as detached. So I think if we're going to be talking about attached, the wall has to be adjacent to the existing dwelling. There's no breezeway.
Didn't you say like less than 10 feet or something? Well, you had a 6-foot breezeway?
I think it should be.
Currently,
two walls need to be adjacent.
Currently, the ordinance for purposes of setbacks and accessory buildings, if something is closer than 10 feet to the principal building, then it is considered attached. In the current ordinance regarding accessory buildings for setbacks. What I also said was that we are willing to create a differentiation for accessory dwellings to include, you know, common wall or common space, so we're not attaching something by a roof structure, breezeway, fence, walkway, that kind of thing. So that's something that we can do.
Because somebody didn't want to go through the process of a detached, could just build a breezeway. That's what you're thinking.
So, you know, subsection A in under accessory dwellings, starting on line 142, this was just to clarify approval on existing lots and to make a reference to the zoning districts and the special use approval necessary. The next section B, minimum requirements in a new subdivision, that just clarifies that that special use approval would not be required if it's a requirement of a new subdivision. We wouldn't want to require them to build a certain percentage and then also make them get a special use approval. So that's what those changes are proposed.
But are we...
We haven't gotten to that yet.
Okay.
Oh, okay. Yes. That's the purpose of that amendment under the standards. Occupancy, short-term residential rental is prohibited for accessory dwellings. That's the Airbnb question that we've talked about. The ground floor area, we talked about this quite a bit in the last committee meeting where we discussed ADUs. We made a minimum, we kept the maximum at 1,300 square feet. We did give that careful consideration and then thought with a BZA approval, that's the perfect place where, you know, if the site just wouldn't accommodate it, that's the kind of review that the BZA approval could provide if 1,300 square feet is just too much. And we added that the ground floor area of the principal building is also a limiting factor. So if your ground floor area of your house, and that excludes attached garages, this is just the living area, it excludes garages, porches, breezeways, that kind of thing. If the principal building is not 1,300 square feet, then the accessory dwelling can't be. It needs to be limited to the size of the principal building.
Is there a percentage? Can only be X percent of the original structure?
As it is proposed, it is the ground floor area or 1,300 square feet, whichever is less. So
if I had a 1,301 square foot house, I could build a 1,300 square foot ADU?
Yes.
That's where I think we need to have no more than X percent of primary or really the footprint of the house. So, you know, I could have a 3,500 square foot above grade house, but I only have 1,500 or 1,200 square feet on the first floor. My numbers don't make sense, but then I could build a structure with a greater footprint.
If you want something bigger, do you go to the BZA, though? I mean, so you can argue, you know what I'm saying? In your percent, I'm not saying your percentage isn't right, but I just wanted to clarify, if somebody wanted more, there is a way they can go. They can go to the BZA requesting it.
Yeah, variance, someone could apply for a development standards variance on that as well. But to, I guess to address your statement about if it's one story or two story, the ground floor area would only be the footprint itself. So if someone has 2,500 square feet above ground on two stories, they would still be limited to that. Not the total square footage, but just the footprint.
On the first floor. If the first floor is 1,000 square feet, I can't build anything over 1,000 square feet.
Correct.
But it can be 100%.
That's as it's proposed. That would be 100%.
I still think it should only be a percentage. I don't think it should be up to 100%. You could have a 1,300 square foot ranch with a 1,299 square foot ADU in its backyard.
Yeah, I think that's a good point.
So what do you think is a good percentage?
I don't know. Can we kick that back to you guys to think about, you know, what would be from a building standpoint, what would be an appropriate percentage?
Is lot coverage still the minimum? The maximum is still 35%, right?
So, right. Yeah, they would be limited by setbacks, lot coverage, their
size
lot
of the lot already. I mean, some of that, it'll probably be hard to do just based on the current size of the lot.
Right, especially in newer neighborhoods, it would be impossible to even do a separate. A detached property because the house is probably at the maximum lot coverage percentage. Wouldn't you find that it's
close? Some of the older ones too, I mean, they build it almost to the setback lines. You know, maybe the backyard is a little bit deeper and it might be, but then they'll still be regulated by lot coverage.
Right, but in some of the older neighborhoods that have larger home sites, you know, and some of those older neighborhoods have smaller houses. So that's, I think it would come into play for those people more than neighborhoods built in the last 20 years. I think we still need to protect the residents of the older neighborhoods who may not have an HOA in place. So, you know,
all bets are off in those neighborhoods.
Not that you necessarily want to follow Indianapolis, but I think they have a maximum of 720 feet. Usually we kind of expect they should follow our example rather than the other way around.
But I agree, I'd like the percentage.
Our current accessory structures are limited to 75% of the ground floor area. So if you wanted to build just a garage detached, it would be limited currently. Well, a garage is limited to like 720 square feet if it's detached, but if it's another type of accessory structure, not a garage, it's limited to 75% of the ground floor area of the home.
Okay, I think we agree on that. Thank you.
Okay. And then there's just a couple other things in the standards that were amended. We talked about at the top of page 5 removing the mailbox requirement for only one mailbox to be visible from the right-of-way at the last committee. We added a section regarding foundations. We talked about detached units shall have a concrete or masonry foundation, however, basements shall not be permitted as detached units. We adjusted the building code. We were more specific with the Indiana Residential Code, including Indiana amendments per the request of our building inspectors. Jumping back up to the architecture section, there was a question about how that review would take place. As it's proposed, the department looks at the design theme that complements the architectural style of the principal building, including proposed materials, color, and design. But certainly if a homeowners association has standards and an architectural board, then our procedures for residential permitting would be to ask for a letter from that architectural board to say that it's approved, if there is one. So they could provide, as always, more strict standards than our ordinance would. That is the change. Those are the changes proposed for the actual standards for accessory dwellings. And then the final section is Article 7, and those are our subdivision requirements, design standards for subdivisions. And this is the section that would propose that any residential subdivision with 10 or more lots of 1 acre in size shall comply with the standards in Article 5.
So, Adrian, I think that's going to be a discussion.
Yes, we might. You want to do that next?
Yeah, we'll kind of hit our time limit. I just don't think I think we're going to have a discussion on that might.
Okay.
Is that okay if we stop at the end of 5?
Yes.
I know you wanted to get further, but and then start up at 7.04. And maybe you could redistribute what we did already, an updated version for the next meeting. And does everybody agree with that?
Yes. Yes. Good idea.
Is that all right with you?
I didn't mention it, and we didn't get to it, but as it's proposed right now, there is a date, a proposed effective date of January of 2021. Given just the logistics of the timeline, anything that would be adopted would likely be after January, so we'll propose a new effective date for the next meeting.
We'll just change that as you...
Yeah.
I think we can wrap this up. at the next meeting. And that's early November, go to the full planning, and then council has all 30 days of December to deal with it.
Yeah, they technically, once it leaves the plan commission, they have 90 days to deliberate on anything, any proposal. So we'll choose a new date for sure.
Okay. And department, do you have anything to add? Thank you all.
Thank you.